Hi, I'm Pastor Joe, and I want to welcome you to our midweek watering hole, a refreshment stand. Just a little break in the week and this evening, and just to refresh your spirit, maybe encourage your heart a little bit as we finish our week. I know the COVID-19 virus issue is wearing thin on a lot of people, and so maybe just a little midweek pickup from God's Word. The Bible uses many different metaphors to describe itself, such as a two-edged sword, or fire, or a hammer. But one of my favorite ones, and one that's used repeatedly in the Bible, is the metaphor of food. Jeremiah said this, "Your words were found, and I ate them, and they were to me the rejoicing of my heart." And so many times the Word of God is like soul nourishment. My Greek professor, Dr. McGorman, I'll never forget the day in class he held up his Greek New Testament, just almost worn out, and he held it up and said, "Boys, if you can't fix a buffet meal from this, something's wrong." And that's right. We have the Word of God. It does nourish us. And I remember 44 years ago when I gave my life to Christ, I had this immediate hunger for the Word of God. I just wanted to devour it. I wanted to know the Word of God. I wanted to understand it. I wanted to be able to share it with other people. And one of the things I did as I started having a daily quiet time with the Lord, was I divided the Bible up into four reading sections. I read out of the Old Testament, I read out of Psalms, I read out of Proverbs, and then I read out of the New Testament. And going back to the metaphor of soul food or a spiritual meal, that was kind of like a balanced diet to me. I just had four different servings or four different kinds of the Word of God. Now, let me just put it to you this way. I may not exercise every day. I may not brush my teeth every night. I may not even remember what day it is, but I'm going to tell you, I'm going to have some time in the Word of God. I'm going to spend at least a little time every day letting God feed my soul so that I can be strong. And this evening, I want to share with you one of my favorite verses. Years ago, a very famous Southern Baptist preacher named R.G. Lee said, "If I could only preach one verse of the Bible," and he named the verse that he would preach. And I thought about that. You know, what is that one verse I would preach? What is that one verse that I would love to repeat over and over and over again? And there are several like that, but I want to share one of those with you tonight. It's a real gem. So if you have your Bible, I want you to open it to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. We'll read together in just a moment. Now, here's the background. Paul, on his third missionary journey, goes to a city of Corinth. It's a very rough city. Some people have called it the Las Vegas of the ancient world. But Paul goes there and he starts a church. And the people there are so lost, but then they come to Christ and he starts to share with them the new life. Well, later on, he writes to that church three different letters. Two of those are in the Bible, 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. And in 1 Corinthians, he admonishes, he exhorts, he corrects, he encourages them. And then in 2 Corinthians, it's like he goes to another level and he gives them more of the deeper truths of the spirit life. And so in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, here's what Paul says. He said, "And we all who with unveiled faces contemplate or reflect the Lord's glory, we're being transformed into his image with ever increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit." Now, there's so much in that verse. In fact, I'm going to be preaching on that verse in the upcoming weeks at Oak Street. But for right now, let's just get the central truth. The truth of this passage and of this one verse is that you and I are not sources of God's glory. We are reflectors of God's glory. And the simplest illustration I know to give you of that is the sun and the moon. Now, the sun is a source of light. The sun creates light. The sun gives off light. Not so the moon. The moon doesn't have any natural light of itself. There's no fire on the moon. There's no beam of light that shines off the moon. It's a reflector of light. The sunlight hits the moon and then is reflected to us on the earth. That's what the Bible calls the greater light, the sun, and the lesser light, the moon. It's called Shekinah. God's glory is who He is. It's His character. It's His nature. It's His essence. In Exodus chapter 33, Moses gets all excited about knowing God and experiencing God, and he blurts out to God, "Now show me your glory." And God says, it's so great, Moses, you don't even know what you're asking. And so here's the life principle that I want to share with you this evening. We will reflect what we look at and what we listen to, what we see and what we hear. Again, a very simple illustration is if you were to stand in front of a mirror, the reflection you see would be you. If I were to stand in front of the mirror, the reflection that I would see would be me. And you and I and we reflect what we look at, what we listen to. For example, if you sat in front of the television or your computer and watched the news about the COVID-19 virus for 16 or 18 hours a day, it would be obvious by the way you looked and the way you sounded. You would talk about it. You would express it. You'd have that worried look on your face. You'd have that furrowed brow. You would reflect what you've been looking at and listening to. But if you and I would spend that much time in God's presence, in the Word of God, experiencing God and getting to know God, our expression would be much different than if we watched the news day and night. Years ago, I had a pastor, a very strong man of faith. He loved God. He would spend 4 hours a day, 6 days a week with God. Well, he had a great prayer life, and one day his wife wrecked their car, and the insurance company says, "Well, it's totaled." Well, most of us would just say, "Well, I guess I'll go out and replace the car, take the insurance check, and go out and buy another vehicle." But he stopped and he prayed about it, and he said, "Lord, what do you want me to do with this insurance check?" And the Lord said, "I want you to publish your prayer manual." And so he took his personal prayer manual, the way he documented his prayers and the way he had it organized and all these treasures God had given him about prayer, and he published it. It was called the 959 plan, 9 minutes and 59 seconds alone with God. Later on, he upgraded that to the 2959 plan, and it sold copies around the world. But one of the things I remember as I used to use that 2959 plan was a statement he made. Here's what he said. He said, "Gaze at God, glance at your problems." And the point is simply this. Most of us gaze at our problems and glance at God. He said, do the opposite. Gaze at God. Every once in a while, yes, in prayer, we have to glance at our problems. The Bible says we're to bring our petitions, our requests, our desires to God. And so we do that. But the emphasis is on gazing at God, not our problems. If you and I would do that, as it says in 2 Corinthians 3:18, we would be transformed into His glory with ever-increasing glory. In other words, the more you and I would spend with God, time with God and experiencing God and soaking God in, the more and more and more you and I would reflect His glory. The more people would see and hear and experience God through our life, we would become that reflection of God more and more to a greater and greater and greater degree. That's why the Bible says that we're to be transformed into His glorious image, one degree at a time. Let me encourage you and challenge you to look and gaze and listen and experience God this coming week. Spend more time with God and less time doing other things. And I think you would you would absolutely reflect more of God to those around you. And you say, well, I wouldn't even know where to start, Pastor Joe, so I'm going to give you an example. Here it is. I want to give you a starting point for this. Okay? It's found in Psalms 27:4. Here's what David, the man of God, said. He said, one thing I ask of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the presence of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to experience Him in His temple. Man, what a great place to start. Start with Psalms 27:4, spend time with God this week, and then reflect His glory. Let others see Christ in you, the hope of glory. I hope you have a great evening. I hope you have a great rest of the week. And join us Sunday morning as we broadcast on the radio or on our Facebook page. Thank you so much. Lord bless.